But it's impossible. It has to be greater. And it's usually the Moses generation that diminishes the Joshua generation. Not that Moses did it to Joshua, but I'm saying the Moses generation diminishes the Joshua generation because the Joshua generation don't do it like Moses did. Well, we never did it that way. That's not how you do it. Why don't you do it the way we've done it? Because there's something more powerful. There's something more effective. There's something better. And I know the older generation can't see it, but you are both the older generation. You're both the Moses and you are the Joshua. Inside of you, there's going to be a reconciliation, you know? Inside of you, God's going to cause you to move from one understanding to another understanding. And I think there's going to be a part of you that needs a little encouragement to go to that next step, you know? To do something new, to let go of something old, and to embrace maybe a new kind of thinking and a new kind of action, you know? I think so. I think so. I really do. Amen. Moses couldn't do it. But Joshua can. Yeah. All right. Let's look down to verses 16 through 27. Okay? Because I think God has been dealing with us in regards to these verses and this kind of language. In verses 16 to 27, Moses predicts their failure, right? Where are we? Let's read a couple of those verses. He says to them things like this. He says, the Lord Moses said, behold, the days, I must die, call Joshua, blah, blah, blah. Let's see. He goes on and he says there's going to be a day when the anger of God will be against them and God will forsake them and hide his face from them and they will be devoured and all of these troubles will fall upon them. It's because they've turned to other gods. And he goes on to tell them about what will happen to them because of them turning to other gods. And you know, even as they get ready to enter into the land and we hear about not only their successes, but also their failures, it constantly causes me to rethink God and us and things we've talked about already. A lot of things in our lives, there's a lot of things in our life that has to fail, everybody. And that's the aspect I think God wants us to see with this. There are things in our lives that absolutely must fail. As you can see with Israel, like, was this the failure of God? No, this is the plan of God. It was the plan of God for people to fail, actually for your flesh to fail. God plans for your flesh to fail. And you can see the whole thing wrapped up with the passing of Moses. It's time for the flesh to come to an end, everybody. And when you see a certain failing in Israel, I want us to see a certain failing in our lives because something that's absolutely necessary is a certain failure in our life. And what is supposed to fail? Absolutely wrapped up in this, self-reliance has to fail. Self-reliance. Us depending upon anything but God. It's the same as Israel serving other gods. You know what God wants to fail? God wants your strength to fail. God wants your wisdom to fail. We talked about this a little bit earlier before. He wants everything about our natural life to fail and come to an end so that we will absolutely rely upon him. And I've written down some verses there. Why don't somebody read what's in your notes there? Joel 3:10. Somebody read that one. Let the weak say, I am strong. All right? Somebody read the next passage, Isaiah 40, 28 through 31.
Do you not know how you have heard the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth? He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men shall stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on the wings like eagles. Their
Everybody knows that verse, right?
You know, sometimes you can only see how rich you are through your poverty. Sometimes you can only see how strong you are through your weakness. You know that, right? Sometimes God will bring you to an absolute place of poverty in any kind of a natural realm so that you can experience and you can come to an understanding that no matter what you're experiencing in your natural self, something will rise up inside of you that says, but I have everything. But I am rich. And I am strong and I am able. Although everything in the natural realm has failed me, God wanted it to fail you so you can realize that you're greater than just this natural realm. He wants to take away all of your enemies, everything that has dictates to your life and controls your life, like anything that can tell you you're happy except for God, anything that can tell you you're strong except for God. He wants everything natural in our lives to fail us so that the only thing that moves us or defines us is the Word of God. It has to happen. Otherwise, we're only happy when things go well. We're only happy when he hears our prayer. I'm only happy when he heals my body. I'm only happy when he pays my bill. And if he don't pay my bill, I'm not happy. And if he don't heal my body, I'm not happy. Well, there's no glory there. There's no God there. That's nothing but us relying upon our own flesh. And then God comes, he answers our prayer, and we say, glory, hallelujah, God is good. No, we're just immature babies. Because you can't raise your hand and say glory, hallelujah, when you're tired and when you're sick and when you're broke. Because when you're tired and you're sick and you're broke, you're crying. And there's nothing there. That's nothing there. Right? And God is bringing us to a place where, I love this passage in Isaiah, where he says, even the youth grow tired and grow weary. God wants even your youth to fail you. Has your youth failed you yet? Oh, yeah. Now, if you're less than 80, you still experience some youth. All too often, we think about our chronological age. God wants your youth to fail you. He doesn't want things to work for you in the future that used to work for you in the past. That's right. He even wants your youth to fail you. I'm never talking chronological. I'm talking spiritual. He wants your youth to fail you where he no longer wants you to consider yourself as young. He wants you to know something. He wants you to know that he has raised you up. He has matured you. And you cannot say, no, well, should not say, as Jeremiah said, I am only a child. There's no real profit in that. He needs the mature. He needs the seasoned. He needs not the young man, because he wants that youthfulness of us to fail, and he wants us to rely upon what we really know, our maturity. He wants you to be confident. He wants you to be confident. He wants this to build a confidence in your heart where you say, I'm not afraid. I know my God. I don't have to go fast and pray. You want to fast and pray, fast and pray all you want. But don't do it because you need something from God. Fasting and praying should never be because you need something. It should only be an offering to God. That's all it is. If you want to pray and fast as an offering to God, that's great. Then no one knows about it but you and God, and it has nothing to do with what he gives you. And if that's the case, I'll tell you what, nobody's praying or fasting. Because the only reason why we pray and fast is because we want somebody else to know about it, we want something for God, or you want to lose a few pounds. And just attach God to it. So you see, God does want us to operate in a different way. He does want our youth to fail. You know, it's just... This is what I believe God wants to speak to us with this passage here. I really believe that. I really believe that God wants like a new day for you and a new day for me, where Moses can't lead you anymore. What's Moses? It's symbolic of the flesh here. God doesn't want you to be led by your flesh. He doesn't want you to live according to your natural strengths, according to your natural thinking. He doesn't want you to live the way you used to live.
Well, you live for a certain, you live for certain things. You know, what are you looking for? What are you living for? What do you live for every day? A lot of us live for provision, but that's Moses. It's natural. It's nothing godly. God wants the Joshua generation, the Jesus generation. Listen, it's time for Jesus to lead us, everybody. Don't let Moses lead you. His time has come to an end. I believe God does not want Moses to lead you anymore. He doesn't want anything in the natural realm to move you. He only wants the Spirit of God to move you. And the only reason why you do anything in life is because God is calling you and speaking to you and guiding you. And we're not living in a natural realm. Does anybody find that to be really spectacular? Because I do. And I do believe that's what God is speaking to us tonight. I really believe that. I believe it's time for Jesus to lead us. It's time for all of our natural strengths and inclinations, everything natural about us, to come to an end. You know, there's something individual and there's something absolutely corporate about it too. You know, even as a corporate body, God wants even as a corporate body and the people of God. You know, he wants natural institutions to fail us too. Do you know that God wants the government to fail you? Do you know that? He wants the government to fail you. So you realize that your king is Jesus. You know that? Seems like the government's falling apart. He wants it to fall apart. He's still got us. He's always had us. We have never been in the hands of man, and we never will be. And may the government fall for us to realize that we're stronger than ever because of it. Amen. And we're better than ever because of it. Because it's always been God that has blessed America. Amen. God wants institutions to fail you. He wants the government to fail you. He wants hospitals to fail you and police to fail you. He wants Social Security to fail you. And all of us at times might grip our heart and say, God, no, I'm waiting. I need that. That's Moses. He wants you to realize that he rules the world and he rules your life and he's always been king. It's time for Jesus to rule. And for us to depend upon nothing but him. It's not like other things won't give into our lives, but that's not our hope. It's not our reliance. Is there understanding in the house, right? Amen. And even as a people of God, God wants Jesus to lead us. Will we stop living according to natural circumstances and institutions and always looking for the favor of certain institutions? I need the favor of the bank. I need the favor of the lender. I need the favor of the insurance company. You need nothing but Jesus. May the insurance company and the banks and your loans and your credit scores and everything else fail you. May it all fail you. May the government fail you. Why? Because God's not good? What, Moses can't get in? Why? Because God's not good? No, he wants it to fail you so you will live a greater life. A life that's governed by God and higher than the institutions of man. A part of you that's greater than your physical being, it's your spiritual being, which enables you to live and move and have your being and actually produce upon this earth as you've been called to produce. You're not the one who needs anything from anyone. You're the one who gives. You are the repairer of the breach, right? You're the one who fixes the broken things, not cries out for these broken things to sustain you. Amen? Amen. This is really very powerful. I'm going to tell you, it's powerful. It's God. He's doing it in our lives. It overwhelms our minds, but it fills us entirely. And may we be blessed by it. God bless y'all. All right, why don't you all stand. Pastor Dad, you'll close us in prayer.
Seems like we've done away with flesh. That's all I heard. Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit. And so what we see is Joshua was really ready to show us to walk by the Spirit, not the flesh. Flesh has ended. Spirit has begun. Old things are past. That's why, yeah, the old things, the old thing. Man, we got to let go of that. I keep remembering Isaiah 43, 18, 19. It said, do not dwell in the past. Behold, I am about to do a brand new thing. How many of us, I like brand new things. But he said, I'm going to give you brand new things you haven't even conceived of yet. But I'm going to put it into your heart and your spirit. And you're going to long for a desire. You're going to just reach for it and attain it by the Spirit. If we try to grasp the flesh, we're just going to, flesh fails, you know that. But I praise God, Spirit endures. In fact, the Spirit is forever. Wow. So he wants to do a new thing in you, body, soul, and spirit. Primarily, your spirit man. This flesh is going to pass. It's going to, don't worry about it. Leave it behind. You're not going to take it with you any. But the one thing that you're going to go with is the power of the Spirit that is alive in you. It'll help you to, it'll bring you to attain and achieve and even desire the very things of God. Can you say amen to that? Amen. Father, we give you praise and glory. Yes, we need to reach out, Lord. We want this flesh to be left behind. Left behind, Lord. Let go. We need to let go and lay hold of you, that we'll walk in the fullness, my God, of that power, that victory, the truth. It all came through Christ Jesus, the price he paid for it. And he says, here it is. Lay hold, but it's by the Spirit. Father, the flesh was nailed to the cross, but the Spirit rose again. So we pray, Father, may the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead, may we have that same Spirit arising in us, that we'll leave flesh behind and rise in the Spirit. We give you praise and glory. And all of God's people said, amen, amen and amen.